the last lecture, we discussed about the first numerical problem, that is to solve or to design a one-way simply supported slab. And in today's lecture, we will be covering the checks that are involved in the solution for our one-way slab. So there are basically four checks, and we will be covering four chapters in our beam portion. So we'll be moving forward to these checks, and these checks are very important. So when a 14 marker question is asked, the checks are mandatory. So it is very useful to solve these checks, as you can gain more marks in this case. So moving forward, the first check of ours will be, so moving forward, the question will be the same that we have discussed in the previous lecture. The only thing that has been added is provide all necessary checks. So in the question, if it is asked provide all necessary checks, then you need to find all the four checks. And if the specific check has been asked, that we will be seeing, if one or two checks been asked, then you need to only solve that checks which are being asked. So moving forward, there are total four checks that we'll be seeing. The first of it is check for cracking, that we have designed a slab, but will it crack or not? So for that, we always need to find the spacing of bars, clear? And for that, we'll be referring IS 456, page number 46. This is a new thing, so keep in mind, keep a note of it. In this clause, that is clause number 26.3.3, it is mentioned maximum distance between bars in tension. And there are basically two things here. The point number A is for beams and point number B is for slabs. As we are covering slabs in this topic, we'll be seeing point number B. And in that case also, there are two things involved. It is the first and the second. The first is horizontal distance between parallel main reinforcements. Okay? It is mentioned as main reinforcements. So for main reinforcements, we need to see the point number one. And second, you can see that the horizontal distance between parallel reinforcement bar provided against shrinkage and temperature. As we have seen in the previous videos, that the purpose of distribution strength is to counteract the shrinkage and temperature stresses. Okay? So indirectly, it is given that point number one is for main reinforcement and point number two is for our distribution steel. So moving forward, it is being asked that in the first case, it is given that the horizontal distance between parallel main reinforcement, that means spacing, shall not be more than three times the effective depth of solid slab, that is effective depth of slab, or 300 mm, whichever is smaller. So solving it for main steel, the first thing is 3 into D, as it is mentioned, 3 times the effective depth. Effective depth is small d, so 3 into D. We have calculated it in previous video that small d comes out to be 150 mm, so 3 into D will be 450 mm. And in second case, it is given or 300 mm. And we need to see whichever is smaller value. So out of these two, that is 2450 and 300, the smaller value is 300, so we'll be using this term, that is 300 mm, and the spacing that was provided by us was 240 mm. So keep in mind, while solving the things or while solving slab, if the spacing comes out to be greater than 300, you always need to provide spacing maximum to be 300, otherwise it will fail in this check, clear? So to go to resist going back further to change your main answer, keep in mind while solving itself that the spacing or the spacing of main reinforcement should always be kept maximum to be 300 mm, clear? So in this case, we have provided 240 mm, which is obviously less than 300, therefore it is okay. So our main steel, or the check for main steel, is completed. So for distribution steel, as you can see here, that the equation is given as shall not be more than 5 times the effective depth or 450 mm, whichever is smaller. So for distribution steel, the equation becomes 5D and 450 mm, and we need to take the smaller quantity of these two. So 5D comes out to be 750, and our second case, that is 450. So out of these two values, 450 will be my smaller value, but in the case of our distribution steel, the spacing that we have provided was 130 mm, so 130 mm is less than 450, that is our maximum spacing, so it will be safe for distribution steel also, clear? So after completion of these two checks, our main check number one is completed, that is check for cracking. Now we'll be moving forward to the next check, that is check for deflection, or to check the L by D ratio. we have started the sum using this step only, but in that case we assumed the value of PT to be 0.6. Now we all know that PT value is not 0.6, as we have calculated it comes out to be 0.21 something. So we'll be using that term and the AST that we have provided to find the actual L by AD ratio. So for that we'll be again referring to page number 37 and 38. So first, moving on to page number 38, we will be looking forward to this value, that is for simply supported slab the value that is allowable value is L by AD, and this L by AD should be less than or equal to 20 mm. We need to prove this thing, that LHS is less than or equal to RHS. If the value is sufficient or if the value is okay, then our check is determined. So we need to first find the left hand side value, that is LHS, then we'll be moving forward to the right hand side, that is RHS portion, or you can do it vice versa also. So the next thing will be to find the allowable L by AD. So allowable L by AD will be equal to 20 mm, as we all know. So to find the percentage, that is PT, that is provided, we need to find this equation, that is 100 AST by BD. The equation for AST was AST equal to PT by D by 100. Just in this case, we have make subject of PT. So by providing the subject PT, the equation comes out to be 100 AST by BD. And in the case of AST, we'll always be substituting the value of AST provided. And for what? For main steel. This check, that is check for deflection, is for main steel, keep in mind, clear? So we'll be using the terms that are associated with our main steel. So our AST provided for main steel was 327. So solving it, we get answer 0.218 that we have calculated. So for 0.218, we need to find this figure, that is FS value. FS value will be calculated from this term, that is cross section of area provided and cross section of area required. We already know these two terms. So FS will not be 240 in this case, it will be lower or higher than 240. So interpolating the curves, or to get an exact curve, you can go higher value or you can assume the lower value too. You will get the value of MF, that is PT is 0.218. So roundabout here we'll be getting the value of PT, and you need to bifurcate the curve which we will be getting. So MF here comes out to be 1.6. Now solving it further, the allowable L by AD, that was our case in the previous units, the value that is on right hand side or RHS comes out to be 20 into MF. As we have calculated MF to be 1.6, 20 into 1.6 comes out to be 32. So our LHS portion, that is allowable L by AD, should be less than or equal to 32. Now allowable L by AD, that is my length. This length will be my effective length that I have calculated in step number 2. So effective length in my step number 2, that was 3.35 meter or 3350 mm, and D that I have calculated in my step number 1, that is effective depth, clear? So solving it, we get answer 22.33. So the final check, that is LHS is less than or equal to RHS, is sufficient in this case, and it is proved okay. So our check is okay in this second case. The slab will not fail in the deflection. Now moving on to the third case, that is check for development length. Again, we have seen this a particular chapter in beam portion, that how to calculate the development length. We will be moving forward and we will be looking into deep about how to calculate the check for it. For that, you will need to refer the page 44 of IS 456 2000. And you need to see this term, that is M1 by V plus L0. Now keep in mind, it is very important in this case that the last paragraph is being read perfectly. It is mentioned here that the value of M1 by V in the above expression may be increased by 30% when the ends of reinforcements are confined by compressive reaction. Now if we talk about slabs, our slabs is always resting on either wall or a column, clear? Keep in mind, our slabs is always resting on either a wall or a column. So in this case, the ends will always be confined by a reinforcement. So in the case of slab portion, the value, that is M1 by V, will always be multiplied by 1.3. keep that in mind, clear? Why 1.3? Because we need to increase the value by 30%. So the equation comes out to be LD less than or equal to this value, that is 1.3 M1 by V plus L0. So we'll be moving towards each individual term. We'll be starting with the term L0. So L0, that is sum of anchorage length, you can see here L0. And to solve L0, you need to see this portion. That is, L0 is limited to the effective depth of member or 12.5. Means two cases are being given. The first case is effective depth of member, that is D, or 12.5. Phi is diameter of bar used, whichever is greater. So we need to find these two cases, and to find these two cases, this will be my answer. That is, first case is D, effective depth we already calculated to be 150 mm, and the second thing is 12.5, phi, that is diameter of bar. Again, keep in mind we are always solving it for main reinforcements, so the diameter of main reinforcement was, or main steel was, 10 mm. So we'll be taking 12 into 10, that is 120, and it is also mentioned whichever is greater. So out of two values, we'll be taking L0 to be the maximum value. So in this case, L0 will be 150 mm. So L0 is completed. Now we'll be moving forward to this term, that is V, and V, as we can see here, is shear force. So to calculate shear force, we'll be using the reactions term or the load that we have already calculated. So shear force at support will always be WL by 2, clear? So W we have already calculated in step number 3, that is load calculation. L, keep in mind, to find shear, or to find the shear force, we do not need to take the effective span, we always need to take the clear span. Here you can make mistake in an examination by substituting the value to be 3.35. In the case of our shear force, the length will always be substituted as clear span, which will be given in the question. So clear span, as it is given in question, is 3.2. the L will be considering here is 3.2, clear? So WL by 2, the answer comes out to be 18.91 kilonewton. And AST, that means area of steel at support, we already have seen in the design of main reinforcement that area of steel at support was 327 mm square. So next thing will be to find M1. Now M1, that is moment of resistance. Okay? M1, that is moment of resistance, and moment of resistance that we always need to find from page number 96. That we are doing in the beam portion. The same things, we have to repeat it again. The moment portion will always be, or the moment of resistance will be calculated from page number 96. And from page number 96, we will always be using this case, that is clause B. We won't be calculating the value of XU. We won't be calculating the value of XU max. Why so? Because we are not designing a beam. We are designing a slab. So we'll always be assuming it to be a URS. That is under reinforced section. We'll always assume it to be a under reinforced section, and for that we'll be using our case number B. So from this equation, we will always be finding the value M1, that is moment of resistance. But keep in mind again, this term B, that is width. Width will be always taking it to be 1 meter. The else parameters, the other parameters are already solved in our numerical portion. So the final answer that comes out to be is 16.90 kilonewton into meter. So we have calculated L0, M1 and V. So the RHS portion has been completed. Now we'll be focusing on the LHS portion, that is to calculate LD, that is development length. And for development length, we have already seen previously that LD will be equal to phi sigma S upon 4 tau BD. This equation can be obtained from page number 44. 42 of your IS code, that is LD equal to phi sigma S upon 4 tau BD. Phi, that is diameter of bar, here in this case we'll be taking it to be 10, that is, and sigma S will be 0.87 Fy. 4 tau BD, tau BD can be calculated from the table that we already seen. In this case, tau BD comes out to be 1.92, and LD comes out to be 470 mm. Now we need to find the RHS portion. So RHS portion was 1.3 M1 by V plus L0. We have calculated everything. So just substitute the value, the answer comes out to be 1132 mm. So the LHS portion is 470 and the RHS portion is 1132. as LHS is less than RHS, so our check is okay. So this was our third check, that was check for development length. Now moving forward to the fourth and the final check, that is check for shear. And for to find the check for shear, we will be looking forward to page number 73 of your IS code, that is IS 456-2000. There you can see the clause, that is clause 40.1, nominal shear strength. The first thing that we will be calculating is value of tau v. And here the value of tau v is vu by bd, vu that is shear force, which we have already calculated. The denominator portion is b in nd, width again 1 meter, d that is depth of section, and tau v comes out to be 0.126 newton per mm square. Now we need to find the term tau c, and for that we need to find the term ast. So ast we have already calculated in the main reinforcement section, that comes out to be 327 mm square, and for that we are calculating pt. Pt again will be the same answer, that is 0.218 percentage. So now we'll be looking forward to this table, that is table form 40.2.1.1. So now we'll be looking forward this clause, that is 40.2.1.1. keep in mind this clause will be using only for slab portion. You can see here that for solid slabs, the design shear strength for concrete shall be tau c into k. So we always need to check that tau v is less than tau c, and in this case we'll be using it term to be tau c dash. Why so? Because tau c dash will be equal to k into tau c. So ultimately what we will be checking, we'll be checking tau v is less than tau c into k. This term we need to prove. We have already calculated tau v, now we'll be focusing on the term tau c and k. So the value of tau c and k, the value of k can be solved from this equation, that is dependent on overall slab or overall depth of slab. As we all know, I have calculated in the step number 1 that overall depth of slab was 175 mm. So for 175 mm, the value of k is 1.25. So k value is 1.25, and tau c, tau c can be calculated from the table 19, as we all know, and given in page number 74. So solving that, we get answer 0.41. So the final answer, that is tau c dash, will be equal to 0.41. So tau v is less than tau c dash, here it is proved, and our final check is completed. So this was the same example that was solved in the previous video. The same example is being given, you just need to find the checks regarding it, and this will be your exam exercise problem today. So in the next session onwards, we will be looking forward to the continuous slabs. Okay.